and welcome back to our channel, The WedEd.
Welcome back. Today we are going to be discussing my least favourite topic.
But my favourite topic.
Social media.
And the importance of social media as a wedding planner.
I can't bear social media. It changes all the time. Even when you think you've mastered something, Instagram brings out something else.
Yeah.
Or Threads arrives, or Twitter rebrands as X.
But no, this is why it's really important to stay current, because I'd say personally, social media this day and age is the most important marketing tool as a wedding planner. But I mean, how has that changed? Because you started, say, what, 15 years ago, mm-hmm. and it wasn't really, I mean, it was around, but it wasn't really as popular as it is today. So how was you marketing yourself back then?
You know, back then, I mean, Instagram, I think, was a thing, but it wasn't really a thing.
Right.
Right?
Was it Bebo?
Do you know what? I can't even remember.
Share the love.
All I remember when I first set up is I set up a website, which was the most important thing at the time.
Yeah. And still is, by the way.
Yeah, it still is. Yeah. And I had a Facebook page, which I hardly put any attention to whatsoever. I think to date, it has like, because it still goes, about 700 followers, or whatever you'd call them, likers. I don't even know what you'd call them now.
Facebook? I'm sorry, Facebook is just to remind me of birthdays. Like,
that's but you know, but it's funny you say that, because some planners in certain countries, Facebook is still really important to them. Yeah. It's so strange. And I think this is why I have such a big dislike for social media, because you've got Instagram, you've got Facebook, you've got Thread, you've got Twitter, you've got, you know, you've got Pinterest, you've got like
YouTube.
It's just, it's such a minefield. And it's something that we always get asked by other planners is, you know, what do you focus on? How do you choose what you focus on? You know, TikTok is like literally in the last, what, 3 years, been like a massive sensation. You know, lots of people are still learning about it. And people are really asking us, like, we know what we're doing. And it's like, we don't know. We're trying to learn.
Trial and error.
And it changes all the time. So yeah, back in the day, Facebook. Now I would say Couture Events massively. We have trial and errored a lot.
Yeah.
Like when you first came in, we definitely trialed TikTok a lot more than I had. And actually for us, it didn't really work, did it? We tried lots of different things. We did some sort of funny things. We did behind the scenes, and we just didn't pick up a lot of interest. Yet some planners do, which is strange. So we kind of thought, okay, well, that didn't work.
Yeah.
Facebook is, we don't really spend a lot of time on Facebook. We have a page, but we don't really spend a lot of time. But for us, it really is Instagram. And Instagram really is, you know, what I was doing was treating it as a shop window, a little bit like your website, you know, where you're showing all these beautiful photos, something that we'll come to a little bit later on. But
you was treating it, I think, more like Pinterest.
Yeah.
More so than Instagram. And so we actually sat down, didn't we, with so one of my best friends. Hi, Rach, if you're watching. One of my best friends called Rachael Higgins. She is the founder and CEO of Because of Marketing, which is an incredible platform if you are looking to get into the marketing industry, or if you're studying marketing, definitely give her a follow. But she's just a guru, isn't she, with all things social media and marketing.
Yeah.
And she was so kind to jump on a call with us, and we was on the call for about an hour. Mm-hmm. And we said, Rach, you know, we're really struggling to find a direction to go in. And I think one of the things that I really wanted to focus on when I came into Couture Events is really leveling up with I seen where the improvement could be made with social media.
Yeah.
And that's where my strengths lie. And I really wanted to help with that. So yeah, we jumped on the call with Rach, and she kind of did a full analysis of our social media profiles, didn't she?
It was so interesting having somebody with a professional head. You know, in my eyes, I'm like, I need that on Instagram. I need those three photos that show the same event,
that
are all cohesive, you know, that looks amazing, and the flowers. And I thought my Instagram looked amazing before you came in. I was like,
which it did. But it wasn't serving the right purpose.
Yeah.
And that's what Rachael told us. She said, look, it's absolutely beautiful. I go there and it looks incredible, but I don't know who you are. Mm-hmm. I don't know what your story is. I don't know what makes you stand out as a planner. I don't know why I should hire you. You know, I don't see any behind the scenes. There's no faces on there. And we thought, you know what? Yeah, we're looking at it from our perspective as if it's a portfolio, and, you know, we're proud of our work and we want to show it. But obviously, Instagram and social media in general is a marketing tool. And in order to do that, you need to look at it from a consumer's perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So we actually, from that call, didn't we? We sat down and we really reevaluated, okay, how can we transform our profiles and look at it from that perspective? You know, how can they benefit from the content that we're putting out. Mm-hmm. So we started out, didn't we? And was, as Hannah said just before, we started doing some funny things and we sat down, we put it in the calendar, didn't we? We was like, right, we'll have a day, a content day, and we'll do a Q&A. So we set it up on the ring light, didn't we, the iPhone. And we was, you know, asking each other questions and all the bloopers and the funny moments. And we didn't post any of it because we looked at it and we thought, yeah, this is us. This is the Hannah and Laura that you get on setups and during your planning process. But it's like...
It wasn't couture, professional enough.
Well, couture events, you've got to really understand, you know, your brand and your business. And there's all good taking advice and saying, okay, we need to put more of our faces on it. But it's, you've got to really... Only you know your brand and your business yourself, and is it relevant? And you've got to really make that executive decision. And we looked at that content and we was like, yeah, it's funny and people know who we are, but it's just not relevant at all. It's still not serving the right purpose. Mm-hmm. You know, and we do have a lot of corporate clients on couture events, and you know, a good chunk of the business is corporate events. Mm-hmm. So we needed to take that into consideration as well. Which is why partly what led us to creating the WedEd, actually, because we was like, the WedEd is a more vibrant community. You know, it's a lot more stripped back, laid back, and it's a platform where we can be our unfiltered selves. Mm-hmm. And for the people who follow couture events and follow the story and want to see that side, can follow the WedEd and see more of us there. And the clients of ours that are more corporate or are not so interested to flick through these kinds of things on their timeline. Mm-hmm. Can stick with the content that we've got.
Yeah, and it actually, from speaking to Rachael as well, it really made me look at what we were putting out there. And when I listened to her and I put myself into the bride shoes or the groom shoes or the client shoes, should I say, any client, I looked at it and I was like, also, this isn't helpful. Like, yeah. I can see that you do really, really nice, beautiful events, right?
Yeah.
But I'm not learning anything.
Yeah.
I'm not. So we're actually trialing something at the moment. It's very new for us on Instagram. And rather than just showing our beautiful weddings, we also want brides to be able to come to that page to learn something. So, mm-hmm. And it could be that we're not even their planner. That's the idea. We want to get the following. We're not even planning for them, but they are planning their own day, or they're using another planner, or they're in a different country. But the content that we give them is really helpful. So, you know, things you do on your wedding day, you know, things you're not meant to do, you know, timelines to follow, like making it just a little bit more informative so that actually, yes, we show that we do beautiful weddings, but also, we're giving brides information for free, from experience, you know,
I think
on a platform.
I think as well, it's really important to understand that when we say social media is a marketing tool, it's not just marketing to get clients.
No.
It's, you know, it's being shared. So create content that, you know, the person that's sharing it might not be a direct end client for you, but mm-hmm. they're sharing it to someone and they're passing it on and they're passing it on. Mm-hmm. And before you know it, you're known as someone in the industry that knows what they're talking about.
That has a voice.
Exactly, yeah. And by putting the content out there, like, for example, the do's and don'ts or best bridal boutiques in Dubai, which is a post that we recently did, you make yourselves out that you are knowledgeable and people can trust you through your social media. You can't expect somebody to develop trust with you to be their wedding planner for the most important day of their lives just from a beautiful picture. As nice as it is, and you do also need to showcase your work, of course, but is it serving a purpose?
Definitely.
And by doing this as well, you can extend your reach by getting people to share it. So for example, we did do that post on bridal boutiques. You know, for anyone who's getting married in Dubai and is struggling to find a wedding dress or doesn't know where to start, we tagged what we thought is some of the best leading bridal boutiques here in Dubai, and they reposted it, and that was more exposure for us. I mean, we didn't do it just purely for that purpose. We do believe, you know, all these companies deserve a shout out. But some of them were so kind enough to repost us, and that's exposure for us. So that's where, you know, tagging and reposting and collaborating on posts come in really useful.
Definitely. I think as well, like, one of the, talking about collaborations, one of the things that social media, you kind of have to do now, like back in the day, if you wanted to promote your company, like actually market it and spend money, then you'd do it with Google AdWords. You'd actually have to spend money to get your business to be visible somewhere. Generally it was Google, right? Whereas now visibility is massively coming from working with you know, influencers,
yeah.
which in fact, this isn't just for us, this is massive brands. I mean, a massive part of their marketing budget now goes to working with influencers. Mm-hmm. And this is actually something that, again, we've trialed. And, you know, there was a lot of positives that came out of it. And there was a lot of lessons that yeah. we learned from it as well. So we did the iftar setup for Nora and Khalid, who are a very well-known Arabic couple, married couple here. They'd recently got married. They're so smart in how they present themselves on social media. Their wedding went into the New York Times. It literally went all over the world, yeah. viral. So it was very current for what they were posting and then us working with them. And we contacted them and actually said to them, you know, you're doing, you know, it was Ramadan at the time.
Yeah.
And, you know, are you celebrating and doing some sort of iftar? We would love to do an iftar with you, knowing that iftar would be small. It wouldn't be a massive setup from our side.
Yeah. The reason we reached out to them just quickly is that because they are kind of out of the box and so creative, and mm-hmm. we wanted to do iftar in a non-conventional way and, yeah. and create something really cool. So that's why it's really important to choose your influencers correctly.
Yeah, no, true. But the purpose that why Laura and I went into that is, side note, we've been doing a lot of Western weddings recently yeah. and we were really trying to open up the Arabic market yeah. again, because we've done a lot of sort of local weddings, Emirati weddings, and we've seen sort of a downturn of that and a lot more Westerners, which is amazing. But actually, you know, we miss our Arabic clients.
But we wanted to have a fair mix.
So. 100%. We wanted to bring that sort of, that following back to our Instagram.
Yeah.
And that was the only purpose why we did that collaboration,
which was a mistake.
We weren't prepared for what happened. So literally overnight, Laura's messaging
that Friday night. So it was a Friday night, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And so we'd left as the guests started to arrive. That's when we left.
Yeah.
And from that moment, because cleverly they also invited influencers, didn't they, that was also tagging and resharing.
Yeah.
And she made it very clear, make sure you tag Couture Events Worldwide. And oh my God, I was driving home.
I went straight out for dinner and it was like, bing, 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 bing.
Hannah. 1,500 followers on that Friday night.
Yeah, overnight. Yeah, like genuine followers.
I lost count over yeah. the next couple of days, but and genuine, mm-hmm, genuine mm-hmm. followers that are, you know, because this is what happens when you have these influencers. You genuinely have like super fans,
mm-hmm, yeah.
you know, and they get so invested in the content and, you know, and they came over to our page. But what that did consequently is we ended up getting, I think it was about 8 iftar inquiries. They said, oh, we've seen how much for this? They'd send the picture. We've seen this. We really want you could do this. And obviously, we was approaching the end of Ramadan.
I think it was only maybe 5 days left of Ramadan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we were already booked out. Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. we just thought, oh, we didn't realize it would generate
inquiries.
Business. Yeah, iftar inquiries. You know, we haven't got time.
It's obvious that it would have. But Laura and I were thinking, well, it's we're not known for doing iftar
and
setups.
And I think as well, I really think we underestimated how successful it would be.
Yeah.
I mean, we overlooked the power of influencers, really. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And because the thing is as well, a lot of people do buy their followers, and it was a test in the water for us. So like, you know, is it going to gain some traction? Is it not? As I said, we are trialing and erroring different things with our social media. So it was kind of just a mm-hmm. we'll test the waters, but oh my God,
it was crazy.
Off.
So we actually had to turn down business, which we don't we don't do a huge amount of time.
We tried to avoid, yeah.
Yeah, we tried yeah. to avoid it. And we did have to turn a handful of people down, which was such a shame, and we weren't prepared. So moving forward, you know, if anybody is starting to think, right, I want to start collaborating with influencers, like Laura says, number one, make sure you choose the right influencers for you that yeah. are going to give the right experience for the people that are following your brand who you want to follow your brand. But also, secondly, be prepared for the unexpected. You know,
yep.
you might be inundated with wedding inquiries, with event inquiries, with corporate inquiries, depending on who you work with.
Mm-hmm.
Be prepared for that. Do you have the team? Do you have the infrastructure? Do you have the email capacity? Do you have, like, just so many things? Even
choose
if
your timing wisely.
Definitely.
It's really important as well, about on the topic of timing, really kind of choose the best timing for you when you are a little bit quiet, because wedding planning to an extent is seasonal.
Mm-hmm.
So you do have moments in the year where are stagnant as such.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, be clever with your time and schedule a collaboration during that time where you know you've got the open space in your diary to book clients in if needs be.
Definitely. And social media actually acts as a tool in those stagnant periods to give, you know, great content to fill your time up. I mean, I know that when you first came into Couture Events, you created a calendar of, you know, sort of special dates or dates that I didn't even know existed, like, you know, happy girlfriend day, like didn't even know that was a thing.
Yeah, that's really important as well for if you are already, even in the industry and you don't do this, create a calendar. So we have our own personal calendars, don't we? That's combined, so we can
which
see where
full right now.
Where we can, so we can see where each other is. And we created a second calendar, which is purely for marketing. Mm-hmm. And I literally just went on Google, guys, just type it in. There was multiple pages that just said all the events that run throughout the, you know, the big ones, Oktoberfest, Diwali, mm-hmm. Ramadan, mm-hmm. Christmas, you know. But then there was also the random ones like National Girlfriend Day or
Women's International Day,
yeah.
Which, you know, gives you great content. You exactly. know, you don't want to be, and that's another thing that I was doing with Instagram and our social media before Laura came on board. I was posting stuff for the sake of it.
Yeah.
And it's not relevant. Whereas if it's like International Women's Day, it's a relevant post. Mm-hmm. I've actually got a friend and it's a completely different industry to us. And she's in the fashion industry and she sells like really, really cool dresses. She knows she's going to be watching this and she's going to know it's her. And she actually sat down one time with my partner, James, and he was going through because she really wanted help with sort of enhancing her. And James is a bit of a jack of all trades, like, you know, what he's doing. And he sat down with her and he said, oh, there's this one post that you posted on this day and you had, I think it was like 400 people extra go to your website, or maybe yeah. it was more than that. It was insane. And he was like, what post was that? She was like, I have no idea. She was like, I have no idea. And it was International Women's Day. And she made a post, offered, I think it was 20% off just for that one day for women to go on.
Yeah.
And she had like an extra, I'm sure it was like 4, 5, maybe even 600 people on the website buying that day.
You see?
Because of the power of posting on a day that makes sense.
Yep. Yeah. And the thing is, especially relating it back to our industry, people love a celebration and people love getting people together for any reason that they can. So if there is a celebration, for example, like International Women's Day, it gives people an excuse to get the family and the friends together. Mm-hmm. So that's where it can relate and generate leads for events as well.
No, definitely.
Another important thing to consider if we move this on is another way you can generate leads and market yourself is through personality. Now, we've spoke about obviously showing your face, but obviously doing it in the right way. But you need to some extent show the face behind your brand because, you know, as wedding planners, it's all healthy competition, as we do like to say, but you're competing against hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of other planners. Mm-hmm. And I mean, especially in Dubai, there's so many new emerging planners.
Do you know what? I can't believe how many sponsored posts I'm seeing at the moment. And yeah, I have no idea who they are.
And I've never heard of them. Yeah. So you're competing against all these people and you've got to think, you know, how are you going to stand out? Mm-hmm. You've, especially with weddings, you've only got so much leeway that you can play with creativity. You know, people in general just want the same kind of thing. Some people are a bit more out of the box than others, but a wedding is a wedding, you know. Mm-hmm. With events, you can play with it more and do big production and wow and all of this. But the way you stand out is with your personality. And that's, I believe personally with Couture Events, why a lot of people return to us or recommend us is because of personality and how mm-hmm. involved we get. So you need to find a way to showcase that in the most appropriate way mm-hmm. on your social media because your marketing tool is you.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, like, it's the most important sales information that anyone could know is people buy people.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that, and like, not every client is right for us and we're mm-hmm. not right for every client, but the clients that are right for us and the planners that are right for the clients are the ones that sort of gel together in personality. And when you're promoting yourself on social media, it is so important. I didn't realize the importance of that until we really started to do it. And I cannot tell you how inundated we are with inquiries right now.
Yeah.
Honestly, like I'm having a little bit of a meltdown at home at the moment. But we're just absolutely inundated.
But it shows that it works.
But it shows, and it definitely works. And I remember when I first put myself in front of the camera, I was so scared. And honestly, my advice to anybody would be just do it. It's not as scary. And you know what? We make mistakes. You know, we do. We'll be like, blah, blah, blah. And you know, we're stuttering over our words. We have to stop a podcast because we've forgotten what we're going to say. Or, you know, like we're learning, you know, but, you know, we're trying it. We're trying different things. We're about to trial something really exciting on LinkedIn, mm-hmm. which is something that, you know, we've definitely overlooked for many years. So that's coming. So we just have so many things in the pipeline. And I think that what's really important is that you know, you constantly reevaluating where you're at, how can you improve, and then you try again. And like I say, Instagram, you know, it went from just posting photos to having carousels to having reels. Now I'm being invited every day to broadcast channels.
Yeah.
I don't even know what a broadcast channel is.
It's and then one minute there was hashtags. Now hashtags can actually negatively impact your engagement. And another thing as well, you know, we went through that whole influx of buying followers. It's all about followers. It's all about your following count. Now, not so much.
No?
In fact, buying followers and having ghost followers can actually negatively impact your engagement, and your posts aren't seen as much as people with genuine followers because the algorithm just pushes it out. So that's also really important to understand. It's not about your following count. It's about the genuine engagement. Look at, are people sharing it? Are people interacting with you? You know, look at the impressions. That's what counts. Because I personally, you know, I'll be chilling, I'll be scrolling through Instagram. I don't like anything. And I might really like the content. I might, oh, she looks beautiful. Or, you know, oh, that looks like an amazing restaurant. Do I like it?
No.
I scroll past it.
Yeah.
So don't look at the figures. Don't look at the following. Don't look at the likes. A lot of people hide their likes now because it's just...
Which is just, you know, it's such a shame. Like, I know people that they post things and then they buy likes for the post. And, you
know,
do you know what? I honestly get it, because back in the day, that was considered, well, this is really important and people are listening and people are watching. And but it's like you say, I don't like anything. Unless it's my friends that have got done something funny or stupid, or it's their kids or whatever. Professionally, I, like, if I'm looking for something or if I see something and I'm like, oh, that looks really cool, I'll never like it. Ever. Yeah. I will never like it. But I'll look. And if I see it again, I'll remember it. Then maybe I'll go onto their page and I'll have another look. I will never like anything. So it doesn't mean anything.
Just take into account, what are people saying? Consult a professional who knows, who can analyze your profile like we did with Rachael. You know, get some feedback and go from there. Because people are watching, people are talking. And the feedback we've had is, oh my God, guys, you are everywhere. We're like the plague. But that's the feedback that you want to hear. If people are seeing it, you're doing the right thing.
We're about to be even more everywhere when the LinkedIn issue starts. But no, look, Laura and I, we've really got something that we're planning for coming January. And, you know, we are going to start talking about it a little bit more. It's still very hush hush. You're going to have to keep watching to see what that is going to be. But there's a purpose for us doing all this, and we are going to be your number one guinea pigs, because we're trialing loads of different things to see what works authentically without buying anything. And we'll be able to report back and give you that very genuine, valid information. And, you know, from our perspective right now, years ago, I'd put out a post on Instagram maybe a year ago, 2 years ago, and it would have like 250 likes, 300 likes. Now we put out a post, we have like 24. Yeah. It's so disheartening. Yeah. Like, I'm literally like, the post is rubbish.
That's where we kind of like, we work well together, because sometimes you still have that mindset when we look at content and you look at the engagement, you're like, Lord, I don't think we should do content like that moving forward. It's not really getting engagement. We need to do this. Whereas I look at it from like, no, we're trying to transform the content and make it more valuable. Yeah, that got shares and likes and whatever, because it might have been wow and it was impressive, but the carousel that only got 10 likes was really informative, and people are scrolling through and for example,
and they saved it. Do you remember that one? There was that one post about, was it like why to hire a wedding planner, something like that? And I was like, oh, I don't think this has worked very well. And you were like, but look behind the post. And I looked behind the post and I was like, oh my God, I think it'd been saved like 25 times or something like
exactly,
that.
Exactly. Yeah. So as I said before, people are watching and people talk. So always look at it from a consumer perspective, mix your content up. I fully believe, you know, try reels, try carousels, try images, go on the stories, behind the scenes, do a bit of everything so you can appeal to different people, because people like different forms of content and consume it in different ways.
And see what works.
And see what works.
For you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So on that note, guys, please, as we've discussed, this is all organic for us and we heavily rely on your support. So do keep it up. Again, we're avoiding buying followers and everything. We just rely on your guys' shares and your comments and your feedback. This is all trial and error. So we're learning as we go along. So if you think something's not working with our content, or you'd like to see more of something else, you know, do give us that feedback and we really do take it on board.
Thank you so much. We are very, very grateful.
Yeah, we are. We really are. Yeah.
So yeah, to round this up, I've really enjoyed this one, although I do genuinely hate social media. And like Laura says, as long as it's a bit of trial and error, do what's right for you. What's right for us isn't necessarily right for you. Try everything. And we're trialing everything. And hopefully we'll be able to report back in the next couple of months and let you know what works.
And at the end of this video, I'm going to leave in some droppets of the old videos that we recorded. The Q&A, so you can see how we started from the bottom, now we're here.
Yeah, true. Literally. True.
So enjoy. Thanks, guys, and we will see you on the next episode.
Thanks for tuning in. Bye.
So, if you could speak any language in the world, what would it be? I think I would choose Italian or Chinese. Actually, okay, I take them both back. I would choose Arabic.
Astaghfirullah.
Yeah, I think that it would bring a little bit of an extra dynamic to the business. And, you know, I've changed my mind again.
2,000 years later.
I think I would choose to speak Tagalog. I would choose Tagalog because when I'm having my nails done, I would love to know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
It's when they're talking about me. Are they?